those that are heirs to allotments sign the leases. There are members that didn't sign it, but the majority rules in that aspect. And so we have basically a fracking industry. The result is a fractured community. The haves and the have-nots. The have-nots being the ones that live on tribal trust lands in the tribal, in the tri-chapter area. Those were formerly BLM lands that were exchanged back in early 90s. When I served on the council, we bought the Berry Land and Cattle Company ranch north of 550. It was called Cromesa Largo Ranch. We also bought the Venado Ranch in the hopes that the folks that were living on BLM lands would no longer be designated as unauthorized or illegal occupants. Some of those exchanges occurred. However, because of malfeasance, misfeasance, and neglect of duty and lack of due diligence, the exchanges, the private properties were exchanged where the surface acres included minerals. In this area, BLM lands only included surface. The federal government still owns the minerals under the 1 acre home site leases. And that's an issue that we really have basically fought tooth and nail. October of 2014, right in this very room, BLM, they were going to offer 5,000 acres. Because of our statements and our advocacy work and through the tri-chapters, that sale was delayed 4 times, and the ultimate sale happened in January of 2017, and only 843 acres went for public auction. So we have some sort of record of success. And what basically, I could sit here and talk to you for the rest of the day and not fully explain everything, but that just brings to the fact that the most impacted area right now is in the Counselor area and westward toward Nyasi and toward Chaco Canyon. Those oil leases on public lands were never publicly notified to the chapters. And so those sales went without our knowledge. And when the BLM parcel is sold, then the energy companies have the latitude to include allotment lands, state lands, private lands into what is called units. And the units vary in size. So far, the biggest one has been 12,907 acres up in the Nyasi area, named the West Liebrook Unit. Just recently, in July, NMOCD had another hearing, and the unit basically ended up to be 7,600 acres called the Rodeo Unit. And so far, that's the closest to Chaco Canyon. Chaco Canyon, the monument. But all of you know that the Chacoan society, the whole landscape is the greater Chaco. All of it is sacred. All of it has cultural significance. This mesa that goes along from here to past Counselor, Sisnachine, is very sacred. The greater bands, we are told, and we tell our younger folks, that's where the horse spirit, the elements of the horse spirit was created. And so, we honor and respect what we are told. We honor and respect all the properties within the region of the great, of the horse sacred mountain. That's our home, that's our pogon, that's our house. The greater landscape is our home. We value the air, the water that abides in those. In our belief, water has a spirit, air has a spirit, Mother Earth has a spirit. And so in that aspect, I'm not trying to proselytize you to adopt our way of living, but that's just general public information. And that's how we proceed in our work, that we honor those environmental aspects of our homeland. So we find out in 2003, the BLM generates a resource management plan, of which the chapters never even heard about. And so that's why we went to the New Mexico legislature to ask for a tribal consultation. That's why we went to the legislature for a moratorium until the resource management plan is amended. And that amendment process is now, we're being told, could be as far away as 2019, but it could happen in the spring of next year. We ask that a full environmental impact statement be made because there are significant cultural sites within that overrides the Gallup-Mancos shale deposits. Now, this isn't a backward society that we come from. They had great connections with the galaxies. They knew where the sun had set, where it rose. They aligned their houses. And guess what? Those are solar oriented. That could have been very warm houses in its day. They also are oriented on where the moon rises and where it sets. Astronomers, astrologers, they knew the life cycle of the animals. So they were scientists. And so that's what we inherited as we live what we call our way of life. And so in that respect, we turn to science to help us convey, amplify the message of what the people are telling us. And we've basically composed a health and safety impact report, subtitled Oil and Gas Well Exposure. And I'd like to turn the floor over to Teresa Seamster. Let me back up a little bit. I came to the three chapters and basically says, look, our sphere of influence is very small. As such, our sphere of knowledge is small. Can I have your permission to reach out to other entities? And again, the three chapters gave the endorsement to go reach out to allies. And those allies become Wild Earth Guardians, Sierra Club, the NetCare, San Juan Equity, Health Equity Partnership. We've had individuals that have helped us. We have also the Max and Anna Levinson Foundation that have helped us to fund a private grassroots-based study. And as we go forward, you will probably notice the uniqueness of this effort. I'd like to have Teresa walk you folks through the top document. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Danny. Chair and members of the committee, my name is Teresa Seamster. I am a current officer with Sierra Club. I'm the chair of the Northern Group, which is the northern part of New Mexico. I started out back in the 70s and 80s as a chair head over at San Juan College, so I'm very familiar with San Juan Basin area. A lot of my students came from the Chaco area and just generally from the Navajo Nation. After being at San Juan Community College, back then it was actually a branch of New Mexico State, my family and I moved to Santa Fe, and I've been there as a teacher and a school administrator for the last 20 years. But like a lot of people on our group, except for the young ones like Mario and Kendra and Cheyenne and Maya, I'm part of that retired group. I've been retired for 10 years. And I came to this after hearing about a meeting in Counselor where people had brought forth many, many health concerns after a year of increased oil and gas exploration. And I think I want to make something clear about oil and gas. Back in the 70s, there was a lot of separation between this industry and rural communities. There was a lot of distance between the wells and where people lived. I think that living in New Mexico, we forget just how close that industry has had to move in on communities. Just this week, there is a national proximity map, if you will, between oil and gas operations and residences. And it's over 17 million people now live within or less than a mile from an active gas and oil well. These aren't the abandoned ones. It's even higher if you factor them in. So 17 million people living within a mile of oil and gas. And I just pulled up a few statistics for New Mexico. There are 58,700 active wells. 154,000 people are living too close to those wells, which means less than